Church of the Redeemer, we are so glad that you are joining us here today. We want to give a special welcome to those that are joining with us at online as well. You know, the Bible says, let everything that has life and breath praise the Lord. So if you're here, if you're breathing this morning, let's give God the best praise that we can. Amen.
You need no invitation, this all belongs to you. We're full of expectation, we're gonna see you move. When two or more are gathered, there's power in the room. You're all our hearts are after, there's nothing you can't do. So let
sound amazing today. We're going to learn a new song in just a second, but I just want to let you know, as we were singing that last song, it reminded me of this passage in the Old Testament in Joshua chapter 6, and I'm not going to go through the whole detail of it, but I'll just give you a little rundown of it. So the people of Israel, they had just entered the promised land after being in exile for 40 years, and they encountered one of their first true big obstacles, which was the fortified city of Jericho. And when they arrived, they already had a promise from the Lord that said, hey, I have given you this city. You have victory over the city. So one of the obscure things that they did was for 7 days, they marched around the city in silence. But on the seventh day, they did it a little differently. They marched 7 times around. And on the seventh time, Joshua, their leader, gave them an instruction that said, when you hear the sound of the ram's horn, I want you to shout. So on the seventh time around, when the horns blew, the people of Israel began to lift up a mighty shout. And the Bible says that the walls of Jericho came crumbling right down and they captured the city. And here's the main thing that I want you to get from that. They understood something in that moment, that the God whom they served and the God who they worshiped, who is the God that we serve and worship here today, right? What's true back then is true today, that he was the God that was with them. He was for them and not against them. That when he spoke a promise, that he was faithful to deliver them, that he was able to do what was impossible in their human mind, but it was possible for them. And let me tell you, when the God of angel armies is fighting for you, we know that we can claim and believe that we have the victory in him. Amen? So we're gonna sing this new song that says our God never loses a battle. He never fails us and he never will. So I would invite you to join us as you pick it up.
Miracles when you move, such an easy thing for you to do. Your hand is moving right now. You are still showing up at the tomb of every Lazarus. And your voice is calling me out. And right now, I know you're able. And my God, come through again. You can do all things.
Amen.
You can do all things, but fail. 'Cause you never lost a battle. No, you never lost a battle. And I know, you never will. Everything's possible by the power of the Holy Ghost. A new wind is blowing right now.
is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand, when everything around me is shaking. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations, so why would he fail now? He won't.
But I One of the greatest things you'll ever sense or feel in your life is safety. When you feel safe, you have the capacity to trust. You have the capacity just to rest and be at ease. And I want to tell you today, just as a reminder, sometimes we have to sing our way into a place of faith. And that song we just sang about today reminds us of the fact that God will never fail you. You are safe with God. You can trust Him. I don't say that just to get an applause or to get some kind of emotional reaction from you. I want it to really be something far beyond emotions this morning. I want it to go down deep inside of you that you realize that whatever you're facing in your life right now, that God will not fail you. The Bible says even when we are faithless, He is faithful. Amen. Even when you can't hold up your end of the bargain, God always holds up His end of the bargain. He never fails. He always fulfills everything that He promises to do. So whatever you're going through in your life today, just take a moment, take a deep breath and say, it's going to be all right. My house is built on the rock. Amen? Come on, let's give Him some more praise. Give Him your best praise this morning. Out of the depths of your heart, give Him worship. Come on, give Him your worship today. Give Him your praise. Let Him know that you love Him, that you appreciate Him, that you thank Him for His faithfulness, for His goodness, for His kindness. He will never fail you. He is the God who is able, the God who is strong, the God who is mighty, and the God who comes to encourage you today. Receive His strength. Receive His healing. Receive His encouragement in your life. Lord, we love You. Thank You for the privilege of being able to come in the midst of our week and simply offer unto You our gratitude and to experience Your wonderful presence in our life. We honor You today and thank You that we can come and lift up our praises to You. Thank You that You love each person that's here, that no matter what we've done in our lives or where we've been, that You care deeply about us in this moment. We pray that we would be reminded of Your never-ending love, Your constant care, and the fact that we all are safe in You, that we can trust You because You are a trustworthy God. We thank You for it in Jesus' name. And all the church together said, amen. Amen. You glad to be in church this morning? Good to see you. You know, I ask you that almost every week. Are you glad to be in church? And I ask you that for a reason, because the psalmist David said, he made a declaration, I was glad when they said to me, let us go to God's house. It's a joy to be able to gather and worship God, isn't it? Are you glad to be in church today? Isn't it great to be together? Why don't you take a moment, swing around, do a 360, wave at some people around you, let them know that you're glad to see them in church this morning, and then you can be seated. Welcome to church again. Glad to see you here at Church of the Redeemer today. If this is your first time with us, we're especially glad to have you with us this morning. And we'd like to ask all of our regulars to give a good, strong round of applause for those with us for the first time. Could you welcome them in today? If this is your first time here on site, you're going to take this little bulletin you received on the way in, and you'll see there's a QR code right down at the bottom. It says you belong here. Take a moment either now or during the service or maybe after the service when you head home today and just scan that QR code. It's a way that we can connect with you and find out a little bit more about you, and we would love to do that. Also, at the end of today's service is a meet and greet that happens to my far right that I'll mention to you. If you're watching online, the chat host will let you know how to register your presence with us. Again, if you're here with us for the first time online, we'd like to welcome you as well. Also, just a quick reminder to stay up to date on all the different activities here at Church of the Redeemer. What you want to do is go to church-redeemer.org/info. That's the easiest way for you to stay up to all the activities that are going on here in our church. Again, church-redeemer.org/info. Another easy way to do it, to keep posted on all the things that are happening as well, is to get opportunity for resources in your life as well. Make sure you download our church app on your smartphone or maybe your iPad. All you need to do is go to the Apple Store and download the MyCOR app or the Google Play Store and download the MyCOR app, M-Y-C-O-R, and that'll help you stay up to date with our church app. Just one quick announcement before we get into today's message. If you are a young adult, married or single, we have a special event. I say young adult, 20s and 30s, that age category. I know one of the significant things that in that age and stage of life, you want to make sure you have really good friends around you, have good connections and a good sense of community life that you can share. And we want to do our best here at Church of the Redeemer to provide atmospheres and opportunities and environments where you can connect with others and build good friendships. And so coming up this next Saturday, the 11th, June the 11th, for all young adults, be aware of the fact we've got a great event happening, and it's going to take place at the Sundown Road Park, and that's at 6200 Sundown Road in Laytonsville. And it's going to be from noon to 4 in the afternoon, just a hangout time. To get more information, again, you can go to church-redeemer.org/info. But again, if you're a young adult, don't miss the opportunity to connect. And that's an upcoming young adult right there, okay, that we have. And one of these days, we'll be inviting you to that event. But we encourage you to be a part of it. It's going to be a great time to meet friends and connect with people. We don't want you to miss that great opportunity. A lot of other opportunities as well, as I said, you'll find on our church app as well as at the information site. Are you ready to study the Bible today? Are you? Why don't you go ahead and grab your teaching sheets? You can get those at the MyCOR app, or also you'll find some notes on the back of our bulletin today. The unfortunate thing that happened this weekend is I actually gave you the answers on the bulletin, and so you need to pay attention as though the answers aren't there, okay? Because we're going to walk through them for the next few moments together as we're involved in this series of messages entitled Smart Living. And I want to continue to talk this weekend about managing the resources of your life. How do you and I manage our resources? What are our resources and how do we manage them? In this series, we are talking about what it means to be smart from God's perspective. And of course, the Bible uses a different word when it refers to smartness. We think of smartness in terms of IQ, but the Bible thinks of smartness in terms of another word, and that word is wisdom. Do you have wisdom in your life? Are you living a life of wisdom? And in this series together, we're looking at the book of Proverbs primarily, because the book of Proverbs is a part of the wisdom literature of the Old Testament. It is a book specifically designed to give us wisdom principles. It was written by King Solomon in response to a prayer that he prayed to God asking for wisdom, and God poured out wisdom upon Solomon, and much of that wisdom is recorded in the 31 chapters of this incredible book that we're really encouraging you to take time and read through on a regular basis. We have a reading guide for you at church-redeemer.org/proverbs, or you can simply take the pathway that I take in terms of reading Proverbs. I generally read one chapter of the book of Proverbs every day based upon the day of the month, and because there are 31 chapters in the book, you can go through that book about 8 to 10 times at least every year, and just take the day of the month and read the chapter that corresponds with it. The 5th of June would give you the 5th chapter of Proverbs, and just read through the book that way. But make sure you're getting the wisdom of God into your life, and Proverbs is a great, great way to do that. Now, a key part of wisdom, if you're going to be smart, as the Bible defines it, is you've got to be a better manager. Managers are people who are wise. It's wise to be a good manager in your life, because what you manage well is sustained, and oftentimes what you manage well increases. What you don't manage well dissipates or disappears from your life. And so it behooves all of us to become better managers. And the book of Proverbs, as well as much of Scripture, teaches us the importance of stewarding our life. That God has given us certain things in life that are called resources. We're given time and treasure and talents, and those are gifts that have been given to us by God. I'm going to focus on one of those today. Last weekend, we talked about the financial realm of life and how we're called to steward well or to manage well those areas, because that's how your life is sustained and that's how your life increases. You can't always just sit back passively and pray for God to bless you. God blesses people who do certain things in their life. And so we have a responsibility on our part to be engaged in proper management of our life. You can't not manage your financial budget and expect to be on top of things financially. No, God will help you in the journey, but you have to learn how to manage things as well. And it's true for another area of our life that I want to talk to us about today. I want to talk to us about learning to manage this very important resource that every one of us have, and we have the same amount of. And that's called time. We could not say that all of us have the same amount of financial resources. That differs according to your means, your experience, your financial status in life. And that certainly is not an equal footing for everyone. But when it comes to time, we are all on an equal footing. Everybody has the same amount of time every week. Every week, God allows us to experience 168 hours. Same for you, same for anyone, no matter how important they are or how insignificant they may feel. Your life, you have been given 168 hours every week that you live, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And of course, we realize that's something that we have to learn to manage well. And the Bible, the book of Proverbs, talks about what we do with this resource called time. How do we handle it? And take a look at Proverbs 12, verse 11. Hard work means prosperity. And then notice the rest of it. It says, only fools do what? Idle away their time, because time is a resource. Let's look at this from the today's English version. Same verse. A hardworking farmer has plenty to eat, but it's stupid. Do you know that word was in the Bible, did you? But it's stupid to waste time on useless projects, on things that really are not going to get you anywhere, so it's useless. It's today's English version. Let's look at another verse from a couple of translations or paraphrases. Proverbs 25, verse 28, a person without self-control or the ability to rule oneself, that's the idea of self-control, you're ruling yourself. A person without self-control is as defenseless as a city with broken down walls. If you don't know how to rule the things, the resources of your life to self-control rather than having others having to control you, then you're going to live life in a defenseless way. You'll be all kind of robbers that will break into your life and steal stuff away from your life existence. Looking at this from the Message paraphrase, it says a person without self-control is like a house with its doors and windows knocked out. Think about this. If you can't control how you utilize the resources of your life, it's like living in a house with no doors or no windows at all. You'd be very vulnerable, right? Vulnerable to all kind of events and attacks and things that would come your way because you're living without protection. And so managing well our time is one of the ways that we actually protect our lives. So I want to talk to you today about four things that will help you to become a better time manager. How do you and I manage our time well? And the first thing that we must realize is that we have to value, this is where it starts, we have to value what the Bible refers to as the gift of time. Life consists of time. It's impossible to make the most of your life without making the most of your time. If you're not making the most of your time, you're actually not making the most of your life, because your life indeed is your time. And the Bible teaches us that time is a gift from God. None of us know how much time that we have or will have on earth. But every moment that we live, every time we take a breath, every minute that passes on our clock, it's a gift that God has given to us. And the amazing thing about this gift that God gives to us, He gives us directions related to how to use it well, but He leaves it up to us as to what we're going to do. You have the freedom, as do I, have the freedom to use your time any way you want to. As a grown-up adult, you get to make choices as to what you will do with your time. You can wake up in the morning and you can make a decision, I'm not going to work today. Now, there will be consequences, but you're free to make that decision. You can make any decision that you want to make as a free adult, given within certain parameters, realizing there are consequences that go along with them related to your time. But what we must realize is that while we can do that here on earth, because time is a gift from God, There will be one day that you and I will stand before God and we will give an account to God for the choices we made, the free choices we made in regard to our time. Did we value it or did we squander it? And we will, just a quick reminder today, that we will stand before God and there any gift that God has given you in your life, you will give an account to God related to, as will I, what did we do with the gift that was given to us. And that includes the gift of 168 hours each week, 24 hours each day, 60 seconds in every minute. God will hold us accountable for what we did with that time. And so to value time, we need to understand God's perspective of time, right? Because who are we going to answer to about our time? God. So if we're going to answer to God about our time, I think it's probably wise that if we understand God's perspective of time, right? Okay. Now, a few months ago, I talked about time in one of my messages, and I gave you two words from the Greek language that are found in the New Testament related to time. I gave you the word chronos and the word kairos. Anybody remember that message? A few of you do. And I talked about the differences in those words as used in the original Greek language. Just as a quick reminder, the Old Testament came to us originally in Hebrew. It's translated into multiple languages. Many of the languages, translations we have today are translations, obviously, from the original Hebrew Old Testament. And the Greek was written primarily the New Testament was primarily written in Greek. And so it's sometimes helpful to go back and understand some of the original words in the original languages, because we don't always have the same word in the English language to define the Greek or Hebrew terms. And so in the New Testament, we find the word time translated from these two words, chronos and kairos. Now, chronos is a word you probably recognize. You've probably heard the term chronology before. It's what you're talking about when you ask someone, what time is it? What time is it? Says, okay, what does it say on your watch? Or what time is it in the sense of the day of the month or the year that it is? It is a chronological moment in time that is measured in units. That's what chronology is, something that is measured in units. Kairos is a different kind of time. Kairos describes the opportunities or the events that are encompassed in the moment. For example, if I ask you what time it is, that's chronos. If I ask you, did you have a good time? I'm asking you not, tell me what the time on your watch said when you were there. I'm asking you about your experience. What kind of opportunity or experience did you have in that moment of time? And so primarily when the Bible speaks of time, it leans toward the kairos of time more than the chronos of time. Because back in biblical days, they didn't have watches and they didn't have clocks. They used the sun primarily to define their days. And so they spoke of days in terms of sunrise and midday and sunset. And they lived a lot slower pace and they weren't as concerned with the days on the calendar, perhaps, as we are in our culture today. And so they were very oriented toward the kairos. What experience did you have in life? And so when it comes to God, God is looking at time from the standpoint of what you do with it. Okay. What time are you having with your life? Not the chronology of your time, but what are the experiences that are happening as a part of your life? What are you doing with your time? Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1. This is a continuation of some of Solomon's wisdom. It's the book that follows the book of Proverbs. And so we jumped over there just for a moment. And Solomon says, inspired by the Spirit, for everything there is a season. For everything there is a season, a time, an opportunity, not a moment on the clock necessarily, but an opportunity for every activity under heaven. Please notice the concept of season, time here, because time, as we experience it, has to do with the seasons of your life. Your life has seasons, and seasons provide opportunities. When you're a young person, you have the season called education. You go to school. And depending on what you do in that season of your life will often determine how successful you are in your future. Did you study well? Did you work hard in that season, in that time of your life? When you first start your career in your life, it's a new season. You're learning how to do and be that professional person or a person that you're engaging in your occupation. And so it's a season. It's setting the pattern for your life. When you get married, it's a new season. Anybody say amen to that, right? Okay. When you start having kids, it's a really new season, right? Okay. I mean, your life completely changes. And so in every season, there are opportunities that will only happen in that season. Just the other day, I was thinking about our grandchildren. We have 7 grandchildren, and I still tend to think of them as little bitty guys. And I just was just reminded of the other day that my oldest grandson, Elijah, is turning 16 this year. He's talking about driving a car, and I'm still envisioning him crawling around under my desk in the office as a little bitty guy. He's not that little guy anymore. That season has gone. It passes us by. And in the seasons come opportunities that you can't get again. Amen? So that's why we often talk about living in your season. And that's where a lot of people always mess it up. They always are waiting for the next season. I can't wait until I grow up. I can't wait until I get married. I can't wait until I blah, 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 blah. It's always the I can't wait until, and they never live in the season that they are right now. The only season you have is the season you're in right now. Amen? This is the only season you have. You don't have another season. You're not even promised another season. So this is your season. This is your moment. So value the gift of time. It's a gift from God to you and me. Never take it for granted. It is a wonderful blessing from Almighty God. Number 2, when it comes to managing your time well, you and I need to make some critical decisions. I'm going to talk to you about 3 critical decisions that you have to make if you're going to manage your time well. Number 1, first critical decision you have to do is you've got to discover. You've got to make a decision. I'm going to discover my life purpose. Why am I here? You will never manage your time well unless you know why you're here. Because purpose defines how you are to spend your time. And your time needs to be dedicated to your purpose. And if you don't understand your purpose, it would be just like an archer shooting an arrow, not knowing where the target is, just sort of shooting somewhere aimlessly. And there are a lot of people living their lives that way. They have no idea what their purpose is. They're just sort of living here and shooting this way and then shooting off this way and shooting somewhere else because they have no sense of why God put them here. Do you know that you're on planet Earth because God put you here? Your life is a gift from Almighty God. The prophet Jeremiah in Jeremiah chapter 1 says that before God spoke to Jeremiah and said, before I shaped you in your mother's womb, I had some plans for you. Okay. That's Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 5. And it does not only apply to Jeremiah, it applies to you that when you were being shaped in your mother's womb, God had a plan for your life. You may feel very insignificant, but you are not insignificant to Almighty God. You were on this planet for a reason. And the question of my life purpose cannot be answered apart from God. To know my life purpose, I need to know God who gives me my life purpose. I need to remain in fellowship with God who will define for me and direct me into my life purpose. So time is valuable when you have a purpose. You're investing it in the right way. Now, how do you know your purpose? A lot of people struggle with this. I've struggled with it at times. It's just real in our lives to try to, what am I here for? And what's the purpose of my life? And so I'm going to quickly take you on a side journey. These are not on your notes today, and this is completely free of charge. I'm not even going to charge you for this, all right? So here we go. This is extra, and it doesn't come from me. This was originally developed by a tremendous pastor by the name of Rick Warren. And if you've never read his book, The Purpose-Driven Life, I would highly recommend you to read that book. The Purpose-Driven Life, I think, is one of the best books to help you to understand something about you and why God put you on the planet. And so he uses an illustration, or uses actually an acronym, to help people understand their life purpose. So this is not for me, it's from Rick Warren. I'm just passing it along to you. I'm just the conduit today, all right? He reminds us that God has shaped every one of us for a purpose. I'm going to use this word. He uses this word shape in an acronym. And there are five things that you have in your life that will guide you to your purpose. Number one, your spiritual gifts. What are your spiritual gifts? A spiritual gift is something you receive when you're born again. When you come into the family of God, God gifts you with some spiritual capacities to be a blessing in His church and His body. And so we discover our spiritual gifts by looking at, being aware of where we're fruitful. That's how you know. You don't have to somehow get some massive revelation in your life as to what your spiritual gift is. Just watch and see where God seems to bless you and what you seem to enjoy doing. Some people have the spiritual gift of encouragement. They're just amazing encouragers, and they just seem to find themselves in encouraging situations all the time, and God uses them in that incredible way. That's their spiritual gift. It defines part of their purpose. Some people just love to pray. Man, they're prayer warriors, and it seems as though every time these folks pray, or most of the time they pray, man, do they ever get answers? You want to surround yourself with some spiritual prayer warriors, because those kind of people have a gift, a spiritual gift of praying for people. And we could go on to talk about all the different. Some people have the gift of giving because God has blessed them financially, and so they help resource the work of the kingdom. It's a spiritual gift. It's not just a financial ability. But they're all kind of spiritual gifts that God gives us. I don't have time to go into all the list of them today. But the question is, where is my life bear fruit? What do I do that seems to have the smile of God upon it? It seems to have the fingerprint of God upon it when I do it. The H stands for heart. Everyone has a heart for certain things. You have a passion about stuff. Stuff that really sort of turns your crank. It gets you going and you really enjoy it. Something that positively motivates your life as a part of your interest, a part of your hopes, a part of your dreams. It's where your heart is. It's what you love to do and you care most about doing. Helps you define your purpose. Why am I here? Well, your heart will tell you a lot about that. And then A stands for abilities. Everybody has a certain set of abilities. You were born with them. This is not a spiritual gift. It's your natural gift. You just naturally have the ability to do certain things that maybe other people cannot do quite as well as you can. And so God wants to use and capitalize on the abilities He's given you. He doesn't just remove those from you. He shaped you in your mother's womb with the abilities that you have. And whatever gifts or abilities that you have in your life were gifts given to you and abilities given to you by God. The P stands for, and everyone has one of these, a personality. The personality is who you are as a person, just your uniqueness. And all of us are complex, and even the psalmist said, Lord, you've made me wonderfully complex in Psalm 139. Everybody's a little bit weird, a little bit strange, a little bit different. We all have unique personalities, and some things that are fun for some people are not so much fun for us. A classic division of personalities would be between the introvert and the extrovert. The ultimate side of the introvert, I mean, they don't want very much social interaction at all. They peek out the window to go get the mail to make sure the mailman's not there, okay? Because they don't want to have to talk to the mailman, okay? And they're the one that goes up in the closet and they hide when someone knocks on the door, okay? Because they're the introvert, and that's just who you are. And so you have to work around that issue. Some are the extrovert. They can't wait to be around people. Man, they're just looking for a party, and if there's not a party, they make one happen. They're always making a party, okay? Now, those are two extremes, but somewhere in between those two are probably where you are, and there are a lot of other personality traits that are make you unique. And you know what? That's what makes the world go round. Amen? Think about how bad the world would be if everybody was like you. Okay? but it's the dimension of personality that provides color and blessing and diversity and strength to our world and uniqueness. And it's also the multiplicities of personalities that challenge us to grow. I need a few extroverts in my life to sometimes pull me out of my introvert nature. How about you, right? And sometimes the introverts need some extroverts to make them shut up, okay? Right? Just shut up, okay? Right? But we have personalities, and we all have to realize, what is my personality? Because God gave you a personality. It needs to be shaped and fashioned in the likeness of Christ, but nevertheless, you and I have personalities. And then the last thing he mentions is we have experiences in life. And your experiences help you to understand your purpose. Your experiences are things that have happened to you. Some of you have had some very tough things happen to you. Well, here's the beautiful thing. With God, God can take the toughest things of your life and transform them into something that can be used to be a blessing to someone else who's going through a tough time. Some of you have gone through some major messes in your life. Let me remind you, God takes messes and turns them into messages through your life, okay? And so you have to realize that even the experiences, the good, the bad, and the ugly of my life, God can even take those and it becomes a part of the tapestry of God's purpose for my life. But you will never spend your time wisely unless you discover what? Your life purpose. Why am I here? Ask God to help you to understand why you're here. You can make many plans, Proverbs 19 says, but the Lord's purpose will do what? The Lord's purpose will prevail. That word prevail in the original language means to rise up. When you discover your purpose or the Lord's purpose for your life, it causes you to rise to a new level of living. Here's the second critical decision you need to make. You need to learn to live by, make a decision to live by God's precepts, principles, and promises. I'm not going to spend much time there. We're going to come back to that in just a moment. But once you discover God's purpose for your life, To fulfill that purpose, you need to follow God's rules, okay? So God has some rules. He has some precepts, some commands. He has some principles that he wants you to live by. And he also has some promises that he wants to give you. And as you discover the precepts, the principles, and the promises of God's word, then you begin to move toward that purpose that God has called you to. That's why we find these words in Proverbs 4, my son, if you will take the time to stop and listen to... Who's the me? It's God. And embrace what? I say you will live a long and happy life full of understanding in every way. Understanding gives you purpose, gives you direction, helps you to use your time wisely. And the third decision you need to make is to choose your values very, very carefully. What is a value? A value is what you deem as valuable. If you think about it from a natural standpoint, your valuables are oftentimes the things that you buy insurance policies for. Okay. And so because these are valuable, you want to make sure they're insured, you put them in safes, you put them in safe deposit boxes, you do these kind of things because they're valuable. You don't want to lose them. The same is true for your life. What is valuable in your life? And so your time needs to be given to the things that are really valuable. And so you need to choose your values very, very carefully, because if you choose the wrong set of values, you will give your time to things that really, in the end, are not valuable at all. Think about it this way. Let's say that you are climbing a ladder, and that ladder was heading to the roof of a building, and someone told you, everything you want is at the top of that building. All you need to do is climb the ladder. And so you invested all your time and all your energy climbing that ladder as furiously as you possibly could to get to the top. And you finally get to the rooftop and you discover that what you were told was there was not there at all. And you'd wasted all that time climbing the wrong ladder to get something you thought would be there, would be valuable, and it wasn't there at all. That's how a lot of people are living their lives. They're furiously climbing a ladder, thinking that's what I really want in life. If I can just get there, then I'll be happy. But they climb and climb and climb, and sometimes they get there and discover that there is not really there. and they realize that they've invested their time and their energy in something that they didn't carefully think about. The best values in life are the values related to God and His Word. There's nothing, because as we said a few moments ago, God will never fail you, okay? His values are true eternal values. Don't weary yourself trying to get rich or trying to pursue anything else other than God. Why? What? Why what? Why? What's this word right here? What do we do with waste? It's what we throw away. That's all waste is. Waste is what is discarded, okay? Why just discard or throw away your time? Let's go to our third point today. I need to move on quickly here. The third thing that's necessary, big principle today, is you have to target the thieves of time. There's some thieves that'll steal your time from you. And the number one thief that will steal your time from you is the devil. I'll show you why. Because the devil wants to ruin your life. Don't you ever think anything different. The devil wants to ruin your life. That's his agenda. Jesus told us about it in John 10, verse 10. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But I've come that you might have life and have it to the full. So the devil is a thief, okay? He wants to steal your life from you. To steal your life, all he needs to do is steal your time. Because your time is your life, right? You all with me today? Okay, everybody still here? Okay. So if the devil can cause your time to be frittered away in a useless manner, then what he's done, he succeeded at keeping you from fulfilling the purpose that God put you on the planet for. He's thwarted your purpose. He's gotten you off track. And so now that you're off track, you're not doing the very thing that God put you here to do. And so, hey, he's neutralized you, okay? And so the way the enemy can neutralize you, all he has to do is mess with your time, okay? And how you use, if he can mess with your time, then he can mess with you, okay? He can mess with your purpose. Can I get a little amen right there, okay? Come on, I need some help this morning, all right? I'm preaching hard up here. I'm giving you a really good message, so help me out, okay? So I'm going to talk to you about some thieves. How do you overcome some thieves of time? Number one, you got to obey God, okay? That's where it all starts. Why? Because when you disobey God, you waste time. Every time you disobey God, you waste time. We all know that, right? How many times have you done something the wrong way? Then you got to spend all that time fixing it and getting back on track again because you just didn't do what you were supposed to do the first time. And so it's always wiser to obey God. It will save you a lot of time. Number two, improve your judgment. Get better at making judgments about where you're going to spend your time. See, God gave you a brain, and He gave it to you for a reason. He gave it to you to make judgments, okay? And the ability to look at things and make some decisions about things. You size up a situation, say, you know, this is the right thing to do. I need to invest some time here. No, this is really just a waste of time. And so you use your judgment to determine, to recognize situations that are a potential waste of time or a potential investment of time. And you steer clear of those things that are waste of time for you. And you focus in on those things that are good for you and head you towards your values. But you got to use your judgment. You got to develop your judgment, your ability to, before you just react to everything and just do everything that happens around you, let the world control you. You need to take control of what you're going to spend your time doing. And that involves some judgment. Here's the third thing, if you want to use your time well, you got to grow up. Why? Because people who are emotionally and spiritually immature are continually influenced by how they feel. And so by being influenced by how they feel, they spend a lot of time and a lot of energy in drama. Life becomes one big Broadway show for them, okay? And so they've got the drama, being angry about this and being upset about that and being afraid of this and being bitter about that. And it's just an ongoing drama of something in their life. And so because they haven't learned to process things well, they also tend to be very impetuous in their decision-making processes. They just do what they feel in the moment. They don't really think about what they're doing. And so out of that impetuosity of life, they end up wasting days and months and years. I've seen couples waste entire weeks and sometimes even longer, just fighting with each other over the most insignificant things. Okay? Little bitty petty things, because they wouldn't get over it. They wasted a week or a month or a year or sometimes a decade of their life missing out on things because they just would not grow up. You always benefit when you become more mature. Always benefit when you become more mature. The next thing is you got to stay inspired. Whose responsibility is it to keep you inspired? That's a very important question. You got to answer that question. I've had to answer it for my life. Whose responsibility is it to keep me inspired? Because here's the deal. Most of us spend a lot of our time hoping someone will keep us encouraged or inspired. Oh, God, bring me the person that's going to encourage me today. Oh, please, Lord, I need, send them my way. And God says, would you just be quiet? Would you just make the decision to encourage yourself and go out and encourage somebody else, okay? Inspire somebody else along the way. And then you'll discover that it's more blessed to give than it is to receive, because when you give, what you sow, you reap. And so stuff comes back to you. And so just don't worry about it. So it's your responsibility. It's my responsibility to keep myself inspired. Why is that important? Because if I lose my inspiration, I'm going to waste my time. Most people who are not using their time well is because they're not inspired by anything. They've lost inspiration. So get your inspiration. Put your inspiration on every morning. Amen? You know, David, there's a time in 1 Samuel chapter 30. Man, would I love to preach on this today, but I don't have time to because I only have 48 seconds, but we're going to go longer than that today. But David in 1 Samuel chapter 30, he'd been away from his little village called Ziklag. He comes back, realizes that his whole village had been burned with fire. Everything had been taken off. His wives and sons and daughters had been removed. And the men were so frustrated, his army, they were so frustrated with him, they started talking about, let's kill David. We're going to stone him. And everybody, all of his army turned against him. He'd lost everything. He had nobody to encourage him. You know what the Bible says that David did? David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. And because David encouraged himself in the Lord his God, he turned everything around and he went out and he found those enemies and he routed them and he got everything back because he took the time to encourage himself in the Lord. Let me give you a quick word today. Is that okay if I take another sidetrack? I'm going to give you a little prophecy this morning. You ready for this? There's some of you, there's some things that are getting ready to come back to you. If you'll just stand up and encourage yourself in the Lord, God will revitalize you. You'll go back and get the stuff that you've lost in your life. Amen? Okay. I don't know who that's for, but that's for somebody today. That God will raise you up and strengthen you if you start encouraging yourself. And there have been things you've lost out on life, but God will give you the inspiration to go get back the things the adversary has stolen from you. And there'll be a time that those things will be back in your camp again. Amen? Very good. Okay. Focus on priorities. What's really important? Value today. You don't have any other day. Procrastination is the enemy of today. Procrastination, I'll do tomorrow what I could do today. Procrastination is one of the fastest ways to lose your destination. Okay, so procrastination, you got to work on that. Next one is you need to work before you play. Most of us want to play before we work. No, work before you play. Play's okay as long as you did this first. Okay, you got to work before you earn the right to play. By work. Kids, when you come home, do your homework first, then you can play, okay? But whatever it is, it's an important priority that you want to shift off somewhere else, procrastinating it. No, work first and then play, and then exchange amusement for recreation. I don't have time to talk much about this one today, but our world today is addicted to amusement. Amusement is mind-numbing, okay? It's just anything that you engage in that you just completely numb out on. Now, there are occasional moments that there's nothing wrong with that, but I'm talking about an addiction to just being amused, where you go into sort of a zombie-like state, and you're not paying attention, you're mindless in your activity. There's a difference between amusement and recreation. Find something in your life that is recreational, okay? Let me show you why this is important. Because amusement numbs you. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand on this, but how many of you sat before a television and then suddenly you realize you'd been there for 3 hours, okay? Wow, it was 7 o'clock when I sat down. It's 10 o'clock now? What did I watch? I don't even know what I watched, okay? What was it about? I have no idea, okay? But you went into amusement. And so for 3 hours of your life, you might as well have been in a coma, okay? Right, okay? Next time, just go check yourself into the hospital for 3 hours, and it's like... But recreation is different, because recreation, the root concept of recreation, two words, what are those two words? Re, again, create, again. Okay. So when you find something that is recreational for you, it's something that creates fresh energy for you. It's not draining energy from you. It's creating fresh energy for you. And all of us have different things that recreate us. Hobbies, activities that, but not just that amuse us, but activities that bring a fresh creation so that after we've done them, we feel revitalized in our life. Let me go to my last final point today. I'm going to cover this one pretty quickly, but you've got to develop a what? A time management. What's the last word there? Time management plan. If you want more money, you have to manage the money that you have, correct? If you want more time, I wish I had more time. How many times have I said that? How many times have you said that? I wish I had more time. Well, if I want more time, if I want more money, I manage my money well. If I want more health, I manage my health well. If I want more time, what must I do? I gotta manage my time well, which means that I need a plan, okay? And this is where a lot of people miss it. They never put a time plan together. As I mentioned earlier, we all have 168 hours every week. Do you know how you're spending? You'll be amazed if you just do an analysis of where you're spending your time. I just challenge you, do that. Just take a couple of weeks and just look at the 168 hours and just really look at, honestly, this is not going to help you unless you're honest, okay? You'll be amazed at how much time you spend fiddling with your phone. Oh, I just stepped into meddling right there, didn't I? Oh, I'm sorry, forgive me, I didn't mean to say that, okay? How much time you spent, fill in the blank, okay? You'll be amazed if you're honest with yourself, how much time you spent on those different things. And so just do an analysis and then say, is this really how I want to do it? It's called creating a, not only a plan, part of your plan is creating a, think of your time like a resource. Every week, God gives you 168 hours, okay? If I gave you or someone gave you $168 or $168,000 every week, you would need a plan as to what you would do with it, right? Okay. On the same way, God gives you 168 hours a week, and he says, okay, now create the plan as to what you're going to do with it. Take a look at this verse of Scripture. Ask the Lord to do what? To bless whose plans? I'm going to come back to that in a moment. And you will be successful in carrying them out. Proverbs 21:5. Careful planning puts you ahead in the long run. Hurry and scurry puts you further behind. So again, the concept here is planning. Let me go back to this verse just for a moment, though. Ask the Lord to bless whose plans? That includes the plans that you have for your time. Okay, plan your time. What's my time budget look like? How am I going to just start every Sunday or every Sunday night or Monday morning and say, how am I going to spend my time this week? Let me see if I can take a look and I create a schedule based upon my priorities for that week, okay? And I create a plan and then I ask the Lord to bless my plan, okay? What does it say there? Read it with me again. It's okay if you stay in church a little longer. It's not going to hurt you, I promise you, okay? Ask the Lord to bless your plans. Whose plans are they? And you will be successful in carrying them out. So remember this. God can't bless a plan unless you make one, okay? You got to have a plan before God can bless it, right? Now, I'll give you something else about God. You also need to keep it loose because God can change it too, okay? You got to let him change your plans, okay? You got to be willing to let him change your plans. But at least give him something to start with. Give him something to work with, okay? Say, God, this is what I'm thinking about for this week. I'm laying out this time, the time for, this is my family, it's my work time. This is the time I'm going to study. This is my recreational time. And lay it out for the week as clearly and as wisely as you can. Then, Lord, I'm asking you to bless my plans. I'm asking you to guide me and let your hand be upon the plans of my week. Would that not be a far more proactive way to live your life? Would it? Okay. Rather than a reactive way to live your life. And so make the choice to make a plan and ask the Lord to bless it. Okay, I'm done for the day. The time has come to a conclusion, okay? This season just ended, okay? Pray with me. Father, we thank you that your word is so very clear on so many areas of life. There's not a single area that you don't address. And Lord, I pray for each one of us. Lord, we've all messed up when it comes to the way we use our time. So often we fritter it away. We're not focused like we need to be on the things we need to focus on. Lord, we're sorry for that. We ask you to help us, Lord, to get better at this because we know that our time is our life. Help us to use it wisely for your glory. Father, I also pray for anyone here today who perhaps has never given their life to Jesus. I pray that this would be their day to receive you as Lord of their life. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'm going to ask that no one be looking around or moving about for the next few moments. Very quiet, very still. If you're watching online, let me encourage you to stay with me as well for these next few moments. If you've never received Jesus Christ as Lord of your life, today is the day that you need to do that. God brought you to this moment because he loves you, he has a plan for your life. He wants you to experience his love, his forgiveness, and eternal life that only he can bring you. And with our heads bowed, with our eyes closed, and if you're watching online, wherever you are, you can do the same. If you'd say, you know, I'm not sure if I've ever really received Jesus in my life. I'm not sure that my sins are forgiven. I'm not sure that my name is in that book in heaven so that I'll have eternal life, but I want to make sure. If you'll sincerely pray this prayer with me right now, I mean sincerely, not just playing games, but I'm talking about sincerely, pray this prayer with me right now. Jesus will hear you. He'll come into your life. And this can be your turnaround day, your turnaround moment. So would you pray with me right now, right where you are? Just whisper these words. Say, Jesus, I acknowledge to you today that I'm a sinner. I'm sorry. I've missed the mark, Lord, with you many times. Jesus, I believe in you. I believe you're the Son of God, the Savior of the world. I believe you died on the cross for my sins. I believe that you rose from the grave, that you're alive. Jesus, I truly believe in you. Now pray this prayer. So, Lord Jesus, come into my life right now. You go ahead and ask him in. Say, come into my life. Forgive me for all of my sins. I turn my life over to you today in Jesus' name. Lord, I thank you so much for each person that just prayed that prayer. Thank you that you've heard them. Now, Lord, I pray you'll help them to grow in you, to discover the joy of living for you every day, for your glory and honor. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's welcome some people to the family of God. Awesome. You know, every now and then, sometimes you might say, well, does anyone ever respond to that time? Yes, for example, last week, we had 34 people who gave their lives to Jesus last week. It's amazing. And so, These are moments that are very, very important. So let's continue to pray for people to come to faith in Christ. That's the most important thing that will ever happen in any church service. Well, today we celebrate communion, the first weekend of the month. So if you don't have your communion elements or didn't receive them on the way in, if you'll just raise your hand, the ushers will make sure that you get some communion elements. I want everyone to have one that would like to have one. So just make sure, if you need the cup and the bread today, just feel free to lift that hand and the ushers are heading right to you. And I'm going to wait just a moment here. And feel free, if you need to wave that hand at them so they see you, that's awesome. Balcony, we're all good up there as well. Fantastic. Great. Isn't it great to see our balcony filling up again? Isn't that awesome? I'm telling you, all you folks in the balcony, welcome. Glad you're here. And excellent. Anybody else need? Right here in the middle section, thank you. I'm going to take enough time to make sure everybody gets served that wants to be served today. Awesome. Right over to the right here, thank you. Sometimes I can see the hands a little better from up here. That's great. Let's all stand to our feet, if you will. And why don't you go ahead and pull back the cellophane on the top, and you can get that little piece of bread in your hand. When you do so, if you'll just lift it up so that I can see that we're all ready to partake together. This piece of bread represents the body of Jesus broken for us. It's not to be taken of lightly. It's the fact that Jesus went to the cross when we should have gone there, and he paid the price for our sins. This piece of bread is a remembrance that Jesus is our bread of life. Lord, we thank you today for the wonderful gift of Jesus. Thank you that Jesus, you went to the cross and you took our place. We deserve to be on that cross, but you took our place. You paid the price. You took the penalty that we deserved. So today we eat of this bread with joy, with celebration, with deep gratitude in our heart to you. In Jesus' name, let's eat together. You can peel back the aluminum on the top of that cup, if you will. Just peel it back right where it is. And once you have it, you just lift it this way so I can see that we're all ready. That will help me. Fantastic. On the day that you accepted Jesus as Lord of your life, he forgave you of your sins. It was a washing, a cleansing that came, and a newness of life that you experienced in that moment. But as we continue to walk with Jesus, we also continue to make errors and sins along the way. And so we need to stay clean in our relationship with God. And that's why coming to communion is a time to reflect on our own personal relationship with Jesus right now. Maybe there's something in your life that you need to ask God to forgive you for. It could be a thought, a word, an action, a deed, something you failed to do that you should have done. But this is a moment that we can bow our heads together, and let's make sure that our hearts are right with God today before we drink of this cup. And just confess your sins to him. He's faithful to forgive, but he's waiting for that confession today. Lord, all across this worship center, Lord, all of us have sinned. We've fallen short of your glory. And Lord, so often we miss the mark with you ourselves. We don't do what we should do. We do things that we should not do. We say things the wrong way. We hurt people. We hurt you. We grieve the Spirit of God. And today we come before you asking, Lord, for your forgiveness. We confess our sins to you, asking that you would forgive us from all of our sins. Lord, thank you that you're a God of grace and mercy, that as we confess, you forgive. So we drink of this cup that represents the blood of Jesus that washes away our sins. In Jesus' name, let's drink together. You can just push the cellophane and the foil right back in the top of that cup. And at the end of the service, you're going to find that they're back at the back part of the auditorium. There'll be some trash receptacles back there for you that people would make sure that you can drop those by. Also, if you accepted Jesus as Lord of your life today, we have a special gift for you. It's called A New You, a little book that's available for you. And there are going to be people in the aisles, different places, holding that book up. So again, if you prayed to receive Jesus in your life, find that person closest to you. And as soon as the service is over, walk up to them and say, hey, I prayed with the pastor. They'll help you. They'll give this to you. They'll help you get started in your walk with Jesus. The chat host online will make sure that they're available for you as well. If you're new here the first time today, welcome again. We have a meet and greet that happens right over here to my right. Some wonderful people that love to spend just a few moments with you. They have a special gift for you. If you're watching online, there's a virtual meet and greet that happens there. Prayer available for you around the front at the end of the service. Would you receive today's blessing? Now may God Almighty, the God of strength and power, may He bless you in this season of your life. May you walk with the awareness that every day is a gift of God to you. May you find and may you fulfill in the power of God's Holy Spirit every purpose He has ordained for your life. Go and be blessed. In Jesus' name, amen.